Hi everyone, I am Michelle de Mello, a recently qualified chartered accountant from the November 21 attempt. With me, we have Vaibhav Hariharan and Bhavin Jain. I'd like you both to introduce yourselves before we proceed with today's podcast. Vaibhav, you can take
yeah,
go
hi.
ahead.
I am Vaibhav Hariharan, a recently qualified chartered accountant from Jan 21 attempt. I secured AIR-2 in my CA final examinations. I did my articleship from one of the big four firms, ENY, and currently I'm working in a pharmaceutical MNC, Abbott.
Nice
Over
to
you,
hear that,
Bhavin.
Hi everyone, I'm Bhavin Jain and I have qualified my CA final examinations in November 2020, securing an All India rank of 29, and I also secured an All India rank of 19 at CA inter level. And I have did my articleship one of the big fours, Deloitte, and currently I'm working in a big four.
Okay, that's nice to hear from you all. So let me tell you all that this podcast is basically a solution to all the problems. And this is intended to both the intern as well as the CA final students. Herein, we try to capture and solve most of the frequently asked questions by you people. So we hope and we intend that we cater to your needs. So let's get started. Okay, so coming to the first question, which is really a big confusion among the students these days, how to utilize the reading time that we have, the 15 minutes we get before we start writing our paper. And Weber would take that up.
Okay, so the 15 minutes of reading time is extremely crucial because those 15 minutes decide how the next 3 hours go. Those 15 minutes have a great psychological impact. If you see an extremely tough paper in those first 15 minutes, you will already lose half of the game. But if you go through the paper and if you feel it's easy, then it's almost halfway done because you are quite confident. So it is a make or break moment. So what you should do in those first 15 minutes is first, never read the compulsory question because you anyway have to read it again when you're solving it. So don't waste time reading it. The first 15 minutes should be completely focused upon identifying which question not to attempt out of the optional questions. So you can follow the elimination method to remove the question which you cannot attempt, or alternatively, you can quickly go through the question and identify those which you can attempt. So this will help you to use the 15 minutes properly. And in the 15 minutes, never sit and solve any question thoroughly. Never sit with the calculator and start making calculations. You have 3 hours to do that. These 15 minutes are for reading the questions. And by reading, I don't mean that you have to read the entire question in detail. Just skim through the question quickly, just like you are reading an English comprehension passage. If you find any keyword or adjustment, generally, if you look at big questions, if you look at an adjustment or a particular word, you will automatically know, okay, this is the crux of the question. This adjustment must have the highest weightage in the answer. So you can just put a star mark or maybe a dot, some way to indicate that this is the main part of the question, but never sit and solve an entire question in those 15 minutes. And for papers which have MCQs, so just in case you don't know, you don't receive the MCQ question paper booklet during the 15 minutes reading time. You get it at 2 p.m. only. Earlier, you used to get it at 1:45, but now you get it at 2 p.m. only. So when you're planning that time, don't think that you're going to solve MCQs in those 15 minutes. Those 15 minutes will go towards selecting questions out of your 70 marks in MCQ papers as well. So, yeah, I think that's what I would like to say in this.
Thanks, Weber. It was very insightful. And I'd like to add one small thing to that. During my 15 minutes of paper, whenever it was a theory paper, I would always read through the questions very fast and I would jot down the keywords for important questions at the last page of my answer booklet. So then during writing the paper, I ensured that those keywords are actually incorporated in my answers. And it really helped me fasten my speed because I already jotted down those key points during the 15 minutes. So that is one thing that really helped me. And I think we all are from the November 20 attempt except for Weber. So the SFM paper was really tough. And as Weber said, the elimination thing, which really works well. And we actually had to apply it during the SFM paper. So thanks, Weber, for that.
Yeah.
Moving on to
so
the next
just
question.
To add on,
yes.
Just to add on to Weber, so one more additional thing is to determine the sequence in which you will be attempting the questions. So that is required at least you in that 15 minutes, that at least you require at least first three questions, which you will be appearing, that you must understand that sequence has to be made sure. Otherwise, your flow will be lost.
Agreed.
So that is important.
Yes.
And it is always said that the first impression is the last impression. So we need to make sure that the first answer that we write is the best answer that we can present, so that the whoever is correcting our paper will have a good impression on us, and accordingly we could proceed. So let me take up the next question. When should we attempt MCQs, the 30 to 70 papers? And both of you all could take that up.
Bhavin, would you like to go first on this one?
Yeah, surely. So the MCQ 30-70 pattern, obviously it's a new pattern, and to attempt it in the first or the last is a call, should be taken thoroughly basis the question paper. So what I used to do generally is, for theory papers, I used to solve the MCQs at the beginning itself, because it saves quite a lot of time for attempting the theory. And for practical paper, for example, DT and IDT, there requires a lot of solving in that MCQs, because it's not a single paper, since it is an integrated case scenario. So there requires some analysis, and which needs to be, which requires some time. So basically for practical type of subjects, I used to allot the last 30 minutes of the paper for solving. But for theory subjects like audit and law, you can allot the starting 15 to 20 minutes, because it doesn't require that more than that for solving the MCQs. If it requires more than that, then allot the last 5 to 10 minutes as a buffer time to solve the MCQs. That's what I used to do. Anything you want to add,
wherever. Okay, my strategy was actually quite different from what you said. So for all subjects, whether it's a theory or a practical subject, from 2 to 2:25, the first 25 minutes of the paper were allotted to MCQs. So what I did was, I used to classify the MCQs into two categories, case study based MCQs and non-case study based MCQs. I did the non-case study based MCQs first, and since they were one mark, pretty straightforward MCQs, there are generally around 8 to 10 such MCQs, and it's very easy to complete all 8 to 10 of them in 10 minutes. It doesn't take more than 1 minute per MCQ. So after doing that, then I move to the case based MCQs, and I start solving those as fast as I can in the next 15 minutes. And generally that time used to be sufficient for me. And after the first 25 minutes, if I was left with any MCQ for which I didn't know the answer, I used to forget about it, go complete the theory paper. And in the end, around 4:40, 4:45, I used to quickly go and just mark the remaining MCQs, whichever I felt is the best guess. Or if I could recollect the answer, fortunately, then whatever is the correct answer that I could recollect.
Okay, so that sums it up. You could either follow Bhavin's approach, where he followed a different strategy for theory and a different approach for practical, or you could solve Vaibhav's approach. But one thing I want to confirm with you guys, the maximum time taken for MCQs is not more than 30 minutes.
Exactly.
Okay, so
that's right.
You need to allocate your time accordingly and make sure you do not exceed 30 minutes for those 30 marks, and you can give sufficient amount of time for those 70 marks, because even though it's a 70 mark paper, it's equal to 100 marks because it's the same 1 to 5 questions, right? So
yeah,
we need to accordingly allocate our time.
Yeah,
so
it's
I
only
guess
the marks which have reduced. What ICAI used
yes,
to ask for
exactly
8 marks, now they're asking for 6. Questions
exactly
are not becoming shorter.
Okay, thanks a lot. Let's move to the next question. Does ICAI deduct marks for not quoting section numbers in the exam paper? Bhavin can take this up.
Yeah, so although this is a general question which is asked, but I'll answer this in a bit more brief manner. So quoting section numbers is not at all important in the paper if it is concerned with the CA Inter and CA Foundation level. But when it comes to CA Final, quoting section numbers becomes a bit important only if there are marks allotted to that particular thing. So adding one more thing, that if section number is quoted and you're confident about that, then only you can quote the section number. But if you're not confident about the section number, don't even quote about it, because it's a like cruel mistake you're making it. Because ICI give not only will reduce your one mark, it will reduce all the 4 marks which are allotted to that question, because your starting point itself is incorrect. So I'll let you know that one strategy which I follow for writing the section numbers is whatever you remember, that only you write. Don't even try to mug up sections, or don't even try to like learn the sections for this particular topic or for this particular thing. Rather, go for the thing that whatever you remember, for those things only section numbers you quote. It's okay, you lose one mark. If you quote wrong section number, you lose all the 4 marks allotted to that particular question.
Yes. Adding on to that, there are some few places where it is a must to quote section or clause numbers. For example, in professional ethics, you cannot afford not quoting a section number. You have to, and you have to quote a section number, the clause number, not the section number, the clause number. You have to quote it there. You don't have any choice. And when it comes to subjects like law and DT, IDT, there are some sections which automatically you remember, like independent directors or disqualifications of directors. It's not really difficult because those sections are most asked. They are always asked in every paper. So those can be easily remembered. And I used to do an additional thing. I used to make a list of all section numbers, and I used to keep going through those lists of section numbers on a regular basis. And I think writing a section number is like a garnishing. It is like a garnishing on your already well-prepared answer. So if your answer is perfect, and if you know the section number, go and write it. But if your answer, your entire conclusion is wrong, and even if you quote the correct section number, then you're not going to get marks for that.
Exactly. And Bhavin, I would also like to know, what were your strategies to remember section numbers, just like Webhav had iterated. So wanted to know your contribution as well. How did you remember the section numbers?
Yeah. So I used to write the section numbers in a separate book. But I don't used to go through just like Webhav daily. But once in a 15 days, I used to go through the section book. And so for example, like for DT and IDT, it has to be a daily revision for section numbers. But for other subject, obviously, it has to be on a weekly basis or a 15-day basis.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's nice. So to summarize, just like Webhav said, that adding section numbers is really a garnishing to your answers. But since Bhavin also mentioned that it's better to not mention a section rather than mismention it, so we need to keep that in mind and only mention section numbers if we are 100% sure that it is right. So let's move on to the next question. How many mock tests to be done in writing? So Bhavir could take this up.
Yeah. So before answering how many mock tests to attempt, I will like to answer that. What is the objective behind giving a mock test? So I basically understand that giving a mock test is like doing a SWOT analysis of yourself. It will help you understand what are the strength chapters, what are your weakness chapters, and where are the things or where are the concepts where you need to bit of brush up, and where are the things which you need to like grip up. So basically, a mock test is designed in such a way that wherever you are lacking, that things you will be able to understand, just like understanding that what are your weakness. So what I used to do is like one mock test of every subject is required to be attempted. And only if you have time and if you are thoroughly prepared, try for it more than one mock test. Okay. So first thing, this is for sure clear. Second thing, at the final level, this becomes more important because time management is quite important when it comes to mock test. And understanding the time management for each paper is very different. So for DT, it requires some separate time management analysis. And for other practical subjects like FR and SFM, it requires a separate time management analysis because the paper pattern is quite different. So writing practice is also important when it comes to mock test. And so to answer your question, which is how many mock tests you must attempt, at CA Inter and CA Foundation level, it should be at least one. And for final level, it should be at least one, but based on a revision, you can increase it to 2 to 3 mock tests.
Okay. And Webhav, would you like to add to the same?
On CA Inter and CA Foundation, I think I agree with Bhavin. At final level, I would just like to add that if you're able to write 2 mock tests, then that's great. If you can write more, then just once consider whether it is going to be a value add or not. Because if you're already good at presentation, if you're already able to manage your time, then you don't need to always write an entire mock test for practice. You can just set a timer and solve the question in 20 minutes, whichever you're finding difficult. Even that is a good way to do practice, especially I used to do that in SFM. I still remember one particular question related to Sharpe's optimization model. And I used to always make a mistake in that question. So that question I have solved at least 5 to 6 times by setting a timer. And each time I improved on my timing. And yeah, I felt like Usain Bolt.
That's very nice. Okay, so to summarize it, how many mock tests? That would be very subjective to answer. It would only depend upon your level of preparation and how confident you are. And as Weber said, that if you are already good in your presentation, it's better to not sit and write a full-fledged paper, but rather just go through the questions so that you have a proper confidence that, okay, you are able to answer them. Let's move on to the next. When and how to prepare for the 1.5 days plan? Both of you all can answer it. Bob can go first.
Okay. So this 1.5 day plan, this is not something which you can do in the last 15 days. You should have your 1.5 day plan ready in advance. You should already plan it properly in advance, because at least during your second revision, ideally happen in the month of March for May attempt, or it should happen in the month of September for November attempt. So by that time, you should have already chalked out your 1.5 day plan. So what you can do is, whenever you're doing your first revision, you can take a paper and you can write down a list of all the questions which you want to do in your next revision. So if there are 30 questions in a particular chapter, there will be some 8 to 10 questions which you don't need to revise again, because they are pretty simple. So you make a list of the remaining 20 questions which you need to do. Then when you're doing your second revision, at that time, out of those 20 questions, mark the top 10 questions which you need to do on your last day. So this way, elimination will help you to reduce the number of questions and to ensure that you're able to squeeze the entire syllabus within 1.5 days. That will help. Second thing, in those 1.5 days, you have to ensure that you go through the entire syllabus. You should not leave anything. So for that, what you can do is focus less and complete those topics quickly, which you're already good at. And spend some more time on the topics where you're weak in those 1.5 days. By more time, I don't mean 2 or 3 hours more, just maybe 20 minutes or 30 minutes more to get a better grip on the topic, so that you don't end up making any silly mistake in the paper. And yes, one more thing. There are some subjects which even I agree are very, very difficult to cover in 1.5 days. Personally, for me, they were audit and direct tax. So what I did was, I ensured that I complete my SFM in one day itself, so that SFM's 0.5 day, I get it for audit preparation. So I was done with a bit of audit revision before SFM paper itself. So that helped me to get a cushion during my 1.5 day preparation of audit. And similarly for DT, the entire 1.5 days of elective, I used it for DT only, because I didn't feel the need to go through my elective preparation. I was already quite sure with that. So you need to personally identify which subject is your strength and which is your weakness. And for the first paper, FR, it anyway doesn't matter, because you are anyway going to take at least 5 to 6 days. In fact, you should take at least 5 to 6 days for your first paper, because it is a great moral booster if you're able to do well in that paper.
Thanks, Vaibhav. Bhavin, you can continue.
Yeah, so 1.5 days, as Vaibhav mentioned rightly, that sequence of chapters in which you will be going through in that 1.5 days has to be determined in advance. And that advance obviously has to be, as mentioned, that it should be in March for the papers students attempting in May. And the sequence, adding to one more thing to that along with the sequence, you need to have the revision notes or summary which you will be going through for each chapter. So for example, for few chapters you will be going through only the questions you will be referring. For few chapters you will be referring the summary notes. For few chapters you will be referring the marked questions. So all this, whatever you are planning is there, it has to be prepared in advance. That is first thing. Second thing, I would like to mention that RTPs and MTPs are also important, and it should be valued in these 1.5 days. So what I used to do is analysis of RTP. How I used to do is, for example, let's say I'm studying SFM, and this has to be done in the first or second revision, and I am going to the RTP from May 18 to May 2021. So what I used to do is, whatever are the common questions that I used to ignore, and the important or the unique questions that I used to mark. so that on the 1.5 day revision plan, I used to go through only the marked or unique questions, so that it will be that 2 hours mein sab kuch ho gaya. Rather than going through that 6 to 7 hours for RTP, it should be like 2 hours mein sab attempt ka RTP ho gaya. And it's like tera past papers ka bhi sab kuch coverage aa gaya ek bar ke liye.
Just to add on one more thing, for DT and IDT, I would not suggest going through past attempt RTPs and MTPs because there would be many amendments. You should go through them only if you are confident that you can write your own solution based on amendments.
Okay, thanks to both of you. To summarize it, 1.5 days preparation has to be done way before so that you are very sure about what you have to do the day before your exam, and what is much of pivotal importance is the material that you want to refer on 1.5 days. And you need to be very sure of it, that this is the only thing you're going to refer and there is no confusion. Also, I'd like to add one thing of my own, which I personally used. I had written whatever I wanted to do on those 1.5 days on my material itself, so that I know, okay, this is the material that I have to use. And on the first page, I would write that, okay, after I come back from my paper, I'm going to do these chapters. In the morning, I'm going to do this. And I allotted the proper time to it as well. So then I know pre-handedly that, okay, this is what I have to do during my 1.5 days before the exam. And I have no confusion about it at all. So accordingly, the flow would go on. This is what I would personally use. The chapters as well as the time allocation. So this is what I wanted to add. Let us move on to the next question. So, could you all give us some common paper presentation tips, starting with WebHub?
Yeah, so paper presentation is one of the most underrated skills and it makes a huge difference. So, when it comes to paper presentation, I will quickly give a few tips. First thing, always write the question number at the top center of the page, never at the left-hand corner. While scanning the answer sheet, it may get cut. Second thing, sequence of the answers does not matter. You can solve question 2 first and then question 5 and then 3. There's no issue with that. But when you're solving question 2, suppose it has 3 parts, A, B, and C, you have to solve all 3 of them together and then move on to the next question. Within question 2, A, B, and C, you can do C, A, and B. That is okay. There's no problem with that. When you're writing any answer, Many times students ask this question that whether we should draw lines for the format. So if it is a format based question like financial statements of a banking company or a balance sheet, there you should draw the lines. But if it is a general question, you're preparing a working note. At that time, you don't need to draw lines. If it is a small table with 3 or 4 columns, you can give adequate space and complete the table in a neat manner. But if you're drawing a big table with 6 or 8 columns, that time drawing lines is important for cleanliness. Then third point, which I would like to suggest is when you're writing a theory answer, if it is a case-based answer, like generally it is asked in law or in DT, then in that case, you can write provision. Then after that, facts of the given case, analysis and conclusion. You can divide your answer into 4 parts. Please try not to write your answer in paragraph format. Try to make it point-wise. And if you're going to write it in paragraphs, then ensure that your paragraphs are not more than 3 or 4 lines. If examiners see a huge paragraph, then it is going to turn them off. It is going to put them off. They won't even read it. Next thing, always underline the important words in your answer sheet. And please, every word is not important. So don't end up underlining the whole answer. You need to underline the actual keywords only in the answer. And yeah, one more thing, whenever you're writing answers point-wise, write the heading of the point, underline it, then write the answer, write the explanation of that point, leave a line and then start the next point. Don't write it consecutively without leaving lines. And many students also ask that whether we should draw margins on the side in every sheet. So margins are already given by ICAI drawn in the paper. You don't need to draw extra margins. And the length of the answer does not matter. You can have a 4-mark answer, which is getting done in one page, and 8-mark answer, which is getting done in one page also. And you may get 8 on 8 also. So the length of the answer is not really that significant. Focus on the content, underlining. And yeah, if your handwriting is not really that good, but is readable, is legible, then that is fine. You don't need to have a really calligraphic or excellent handwriting to do well. And when you're writing the paper, don't excessively focus on writing in a neat handwriting at the beginning, because in the end, when you write fast, your handwriting is going to get spoiled and that might give a bad impression. So from starting itself, keep an average handwriting and try to avoid cancellations. See, cancellations are natural. They might happen, but try to avoid them at least in the first question which you're attempting.
Thanks, Vaibhav. Yeah, I want to ask you one thing. You said that you'd be underlining the important lines in every answer. So I wanted to ask, would you underline it with pen or pencil and do it at the end of answering your after the end of writing your answer, or while writing your answer you would go on underlining? That is what I wanted to ask you.
Okay, so underlining, I would do it with pen itself. There's no time to pick up a pencil and do that. You are not doing it to beautify your answer sheet. You are doing it so that the examiner can see the important words, understand the objective. And underlining, see, there are some students who do it along with writing the answer itself. And some who do it at the end if they are left with time. For me, it was the second case. I used to do it at the end if I was left with time. Because my answers, whenever I used to write, I used to leave adequate space. And I used to write 95% of my answers in point-wise manner. So generally, it was not really difficult. It would not be really difficult for an examiner to quickly look at the keywords. It would be quite easy, I felt. So underlining was my last priority. But especially if someone's handwriting is not that good, then in that case, I would suggest that they should underline as soon as they write that answer. And it should not take more than 15 seconds to underline some 5-6 keywords in an answer.
Thanks, Vaibhav. Bhavin, would you like to provide your inputs on paper presentation?
I think I don't have any, because I think Vaibhav has summed up everything.
Okay, so I think we can conclude with the paper presentation tips given by Vaibhav. And let's move on to the next question. ABC analysis and the importance of solving past attempt mock test RTPs, which would be taken up by Bhavin.
Yeah, so for importance of solving past papers and MTP, I've already said that RTP and MTP analysis should be done, wherein you will be finding that whatever important questions or unique questions are there, which you are not able to solve in the first attempt, that needs to be marked, and that should be left, and that should be marked for the last day preparation as well. So first thing, that is for sure. Second thing, the mock test acts as a SWOT analysis for your preparations. So it has to be given importance accordingly. And the importance of past papers has increased because ICI tends to ask the past questions and with the values changed in a more, like, more frequently in the current situation. So I think most of the questions in the few of the papers come repetitive based on the past papers. And that's why the importance of past papers are quite important. Coming to the ABC analysis part, if you are quite confident, if you're not confident about the syllabus coverage, then only this option should be resorted for. Otherwise, 100% of the syllabus is important. ABC analysis is nothing but the weighted average analysis of your syllabus, where you mark the chapters into the three categories and give priority to all three categories, but the priority differs from chapter to chapter. So for example, say you're studying for chapter category A and B in a more sophisticated manner, and for category C, you will be doing a bit overall a glance through type of study. And although it's not a recommended practice, I'll suggest you all to cover the syllabus well in advance, so that this practice should not be it should be adopted. But if it is not feasible for you to cover the syllabus, you can resort to this practice wherein you will divide the entire syllabus in three categories.
Thanks.
If you want to add on, Vaibhav.
No, I would not like to add anything to this. Actually, I used to never do an ABC analysis. So for me, everything was important when it came to the syllabus. I never let anything go. So I didn't really do an ABC analysis.
Okay, thanks, Bhavin, and thanks, Vaibhav, for your inputs. I think we are done with the podcast. Apart from that, if there is anything that you all would like to add and probably provide any tips to the November 21 folks, you all could do that.
Yeah, I would like to just suggest one thing. So if any of the papers go stuff, then don't let that impact your other papers. You should not waste your time thinking about that. Especially if paper one goes difficult, then people start thinking that whether I should continue giving the other papers or should I drop it here itself. So no, you have to give all the other papers. You might end up clearing with the highest marks in the toughest paper. Because generally ICS checking is lenient in a really tough paper, and they are quite strict if the paper is easy. And in the last 1.5 months, you might get second thoughts, like whether should I give both groups or one group? Should I focus more on one group? So try to avoid that. Finish what you started and get it done once and for all.
Thanks, Vaibhav. And whatever Vaibhav has said is actually backed with evidence, because my first FR paper went so bad and I was actually thinking of giving up, but gladly I did not. And things really went well for me and I was able to clear my CA finals in the first attempt. So no matter how bad your paper goes, just leave it there and there and come home, get refreshed and start studying for your next paper, because you never know how things will turn out to be for you. So that's about it. Any inputs from you, Bhavin?
Yeah, so you need one thing is that you need to have a constant source of motivation, because this is quite important that whenever you are studying, you go down. So you should remain motivated at all times. And even if you go down, it's okay. There are many days. And like it happens that even if you plan well, there might be days that your planning may go overdue or your syllabus may not get covered. It's okay. You just remain motivated and give your 100% in whatever manner you can.
Thanks, Bhavin. Thanks a lot. And also I think we have come to the end of our podcast and we covered a really good bit of frequently asked questions, which were really a doubt. We covered how to utilize the reading time, which was iterated by Vaibhav. We covered how to attempt the 30 to 70 MCQs questions, the marks reduction by ICI when it comes to providing section numbers or not, and the importance of writing mock test papers, and also the ABC analysis, whether it is really important and whether you really need to do an ABC analysis or just consider everything as important, like Vaibhav iterated. So that was very illustrative from both of y'all. And thanks for being at this podcast. And we'd like to thank Vision CA for giving us this platform where we could actually provide our insights and help our CA students emerge and do well with their exams. Also, apart from this, if you still have doubts, you all could connect to your mentors on one-to-one and they would surely be very happy to help you all. And in case you are not a mentee for Vision CA, you can connect to us and we will enroll you into this community, and you could have your personal mentor who would be your go-to person for anything when it comes to CA. So thank you. Thanks, Vaibhav, and thanks, Bhavani, for your time.
Thanks, Michelle, for your time too.
Thanks, Michelle.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.